are now going to present you with Play It Forward.
Happy Friday, everyone.
How's Happy everyone Friday.
Great. Yeah, we got a full room here. We're in the conference studio today. And the excellent Tyrone, well, he engineers the show. And a special shout out to my husband, Mike, who's in the control room today with Tyrone. So live in the studio with me is the Play It Forward think tank, Chloe, Taylor, Aisha, Olivia, Arcadia, Serena, and Kurt, and a very special agent from the DEA, whom we will introduce and interview momentarily. So great news for our team. I'd like to welcome Kurt Hall, our new vice president of the Play It Forward project.
Woo! Thank you.
We're so happy that you're on our team.
Happy to be here.
He brings a lot to the table. So thanks, Kurt, and of course everyone else on the team. So you hear it all from hip hop to rock, blues to reggae, electronic to punk, commentary and more on WUSB 90.1 and 107.3 FM. Our volunteer student-led radio station is 24/7 because of people like you. Thank you for your donation and continued support. Your donation keeps us on the air and in your ears. You can donate on the website, wsb.fm, or call 631-632-6901 or 1-888-632-9872 to pledge your donation. Thank you so much for your support. Now, here's Aisha to tell you a little bit about our show.
The Play It Forward Project is a nonprofit organization composed of Stony Brook community members who discuss and advocate for awareness, education, harm reduction, treatment, and recovery resources related to the fentanyl and opioid epidemic. We are live on the radio every other Friday from 1 to 2 p.m. EST. Stay tuned as we will cover events in honor of the Fentanyl Awareness Day, which is May 9th. Today we'll begin our show with an overview of the current third wave opioid crisis. So let's talk about fentanyl, a synthetic opioid up to 50 times stronger than heroin and 100 times more potent than morphine.
So there's two types of fentanyl. There's the pharmaceutical fentanyl, which was introduced in 1959. It's a synthetic opioid painkiller that's used to kill extreme pain. This type is legally manufactured and distributed to healthcare professionals in the United States. There's also illicit fentanyl, which is cheap to produce and incredibly potent. It is produced mainly in Mexico, and today cartels use precursor compounds from China to manufacture massive amounts of fentanyl products. Too many batches of fentanyl pills, powders, and blocks are being smuggled in, further fueling that nationwide epidemic. Currently, fentanyl is number one cause of death amongst adults ages 18 to 45. Mm. It is odorless. Its color can be off-white, tan, or even brown, depending on what it's mixed with.
In 2022, the DEA seized over 57.9 million fentanyl-laced fake pills and more than 13,400 pounds of fentanyl powder. The 2022 seizures are equivalent to more than 400 million lethal doses of fentanyl. The 2023 fentanyl seizures represent nearly 78.1 million deadly doses. That is enough to give every American a lethal dose three times over, or a jetliner crashing every single day. It's time to wake up and do something about this. Illicit fentanyl is being added to too many street drugs such as heroin, coke, and meth to increase profits and potency, often disguised as those drugs. It's also being hidden in pressed pills and made to look exactly like Adderall, oxycodone, Xanax, and other benzos.
One pill can be deadly, and now is not the time to experiment, share, or trust pills that were not prescribed to you, even for what may seem like legitimate medical reasons like panic attacks, sleep, focus, or physical pain. The DEA has discovered that 6 out of 10 pills that contain fentanyl may contain a potentially lethal dose, and many buyers are unaware. As little as 2 milligrams can be deadly. Those who are opioid naive or have been abstinent for some time following active addiction and who relapsed are most at risk for overdose. Recovery is possible. And according to SAMHSA, an estimated 23 million people are living symptom-free in recovery. There are multiple pathways to recovery, and one size doesn't fit all.
Fentanyl test strips are available at LICAD for Long Islanders and in other markets. They are now included in Narcan kits, so please carry Narcan and have one at home. Also, please stick to the station. We will provide free confidential outreach resources and substance misuse and harm reduction resources.
Did you know that over 200 people die every day from overdoses related to synthetic opioids like fentanyl? According to the Center for Disease Control, in 2022, there were 117,477 overdose deaths, driven largely by the spread of illicit fentanyl.
Now that we are armed with some general information about this enemy, here's Allison to introduce our guests.
Thanks, everyone. So I'd like to welcome Special Agent Frank Tarentino to the show. On behalf of Play It Forward, we welcome you and thank you so much for being here with us today and, of course, for your service. So, Frank, please welcome and introduce yourself to our listeners.
Thank you, Allison, and thank you, everyone, for being here. It's an honor to be on your radio show. You do such a great job getting the message out, and I thank you for providing your listening audience with those important statistics that you just read. We'll talk a little bit more about that later.
Yeah.
So, yes, my 25th year with the Drug Enforcement Administration, 32 years with the government, and just honored to have the opportunity to serve again in New York and as the special agent in charge of the New York Field Division, responsible for the 10 different offices spread across the state. We have an incredibly talented workforce who's committed every single day to saving lives, and that's our mission.
Wow. Thank you again for your service. The work you do is incredible. So thank you again. And here's Kurt. We have a lot of questions for you.
Great.
So here's Kurt to start.
Excellent.
All right. So you have a very extensive career with the DEA spanning about 25 years. And it looks like you started in New York City. You've spent time in Afghanistan, New Jersey, and Seattle. Yeah. Can you briefly discuss your various responsibilities at those different stages?
Great question, Kurt. As a brand new agent, like every agent who starts their career, your primary responsibility is to learn the job and to understand the role that you play in this really critical mission that we have. And so as a brand new agent, you have to make cases. You have to identify threats, targets that are influencing the areas in which you work. And so you have to make cases and bring those cases for prosecution. And ideally, you're taking some really bad people off the street. And then from there, I was fortunate to have the opportunity to serve on our DEA FAST teams, foreign advisory, deployed support and assistance teams that were designated to operate in Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. I was fortunate to be on the very first team to deploy in 2005. And our mission was to go after the counter-narcotics, counter-terrorism targets that were operating in Afghanistan, the number one poppy producing country in the world. We worked collaboratively with the military and with other organizations and agencies that were committed to making Afghanistan a more stable and safe place. And then I returned from that assignment after 5 years and was fortunate to return to New Jersey, where I was a supervisor, left as a supervisor in FAST and a team leader in FAST and a supervisor in New Jersey. And similar to my experience in New York, the difference now is as a supervisor, you're responsible for roughly 10 to 12 agents that now have to make cases, right? So it's a team. And then from there, I was promoted to an ASAC, and I was fortunate to then now have multiple 5 to 6 different groups that had 10 to 12 agents that had to make cases. And then from there, I was fortunate to get promoted to be the special agent in charge of the Seattle Field Division. Mm-hmm. So that division is the largest geographical division in DEA. It encompasses 4 states, Washington, Idaho, Oregon, and Alaska. So really big footprint, great work, direct link between the Mexican cartels and the Pacific Northwest, right up the I-5 corridor. And then as anybody would sign up for. I was very fortunate to then get the opportunity to come back as a special agent in charge of the New York division where I started my career. So it's like full circle.
Right.
Wow. So very, very fortunate, and just every single day blessed to have such incredible people that do amazing work and that, again, are committed to saving lives.
Wow. That's really impressive. That's quite an extensive all over the place background you have there. So you have been the special agent in charge of the New York division for over a year now. What are some challenges that you faced in that time? I'm sure it's a lot to take on, a large amount of responsibility.
Yeah, I mean, the challenges, I think, are not that distinct or dissimilar than the challenges that every other division across the country faces, and that is just the threat that the Mexican cartels have continued to present in New York State, and specifically in New York City, and then, of course, the synthetic drugs that continue to cause the most harm in these areas. The drug trafficking that existed when I started my career is far different today than it was then. A lot of plant-based drugs were predominant back then and still are important today in the drug world, but synthetic man-made drugs are now starting to replace some of the plant-based drugs.
Wow. Wow, that's great. Thank you.
So kind of shifting gears a little bit, I kind of want to know more about your personal motivation to pursue this line of work. I know it can be very dangerous, so I'm just curious as to why you're doing what you do.
Well, thank you, Aisha. It's a great question. You know, my whole life, I've always been drawn to service. I was fortunate to attend a military college and then get my commission out of Norwich University in the infantry as an infantry officer. I was very fortunate to get some really great assignments to include 1st Ranger Battalion. And during that time, I think I really understood the value of team and commitment and dedication to a mission of life-saving aspects. And I think that, you know, when you're drawn to a great organization like the Ranger Regiment or like the military or like in law enforcement, where you have this unified commitment, and you have this sense of purpose. And then again, it's all about service. That's what drew me to the DEA. And to this day, you know, I wake up every single day wondering how much more I can do and how I could recommit to this important work that we do. And so that's what drives me. And that's what, you know, I wake up every day thinking how blessed I am to have that opportunity.
Hmm. Wow. What an amazing answer.
Yes.
You know, that kind of reminds me of myself, too, because that's, like, why I want to pursue medicine. But this isn't about me. So, can you...
Sure it is.
Can you tell the listeners about an accomplishment that you are particularly proud of, something that's close to your heart?
Wow, that's a great question. I'm just really proud of the fact that, you know, every single day in New York and throughout DEA, we work really hard to develop high-functioning, high-performing teams that are committed to the work that we do and that have, you know, the clarity and purpose and the understanding of what we do, how we do it, and most importantly, why we do what we do. So it's really, to me, the success of building these teams that are interdependent but yet have the ability to operate together in a joint way and in a cross-functional way. To me, that is the true measure of success.
Wow. I agree. Okay, Chloe has some questions for you.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your amazing service. It's so needed nowadays. And
absolutely.
It's, yeah. My question, one of my questions is, what is a typical job, like a day on the job, look like for you? And are you ever, like, concerned for your family's safety or your own? I feel like I would be scared if I was a DEA agent prosecuting members of the cartel.
So it's a great question, Chloe, that, again, you know, as a young agent and as the agents that work in the New York division across the country, when they're making their investigations and they're on the street every day, they're in a very clandestine, undercover environment. They do not present themselves as DEA agents. They don't wear a uniform. And so a lot of times they are behind the scenes and they're working very closely with our state and local counterparts. And so in that aspect, the threat is more from violence and or organizations that look to do harm to law enforcement. In my current position, and for the last probably decade, I've been more in the spotlight as in the media and more of a forward-facing position. And so, you know, my name is out there, whether it's a press release or a press conference. And so, you know, it does present some lack of anonymity. And so, but I'm not concerned about that. I think that, you know, we have a really good sense of when we cross that line and when we need to be concerned. And I don't feel that way.
Well, thank you so much for, you know, discussing that. And again, thank you so much for your service and bravery with all of this.
Thank you.
So the drug cartels are obviously capitalizing off of demand. Mm-hmm. And, you know, arresting, you know, these major cartel members, won't people just keep indefinitely taking that person's place? And what can be done about the demand?
Yeah. So the cartels have been around for a long time. They go back to 1970, as a matter of fact. The first evolution of the cartels began in Mexico with the Guadalajara cartel. There's evidence of the cartels continuing to evolve. What DEA is focused on right now is not necessarily going after one specific person or a specific area of Mexico. This is about going after and defeating the two most prominent cartels that are causing the most harm, and that's Sinaloa and CJNG, or the Jalisco cartel. So DEA is focused at right now defeating the network and completely taking out the cartels. We've recently announced an indictment, a 28-person indictment, going after the Sinaloa cartel, the Chapitos. Wow. So those are the sons of El Chapo, Joaquin Guzman. So this is the DEA's effort to completely annihilate the cartels. And so that's a different model than just taking one person at a time. And that is something that is difficult, right? Because somebody will replace the next cartel member, right?
Yeah. Well, that's amazing. And I think, you know, to go after the entire cartel, to, you know, those two major cartels is so needed and absolutely incredible. From a prevention standpoint, mm-hmm. I know that the DEA is involved as well. You mentioned it's a multi-pronged approach, you know, to this crisis that's going on. And I'm curious, like, how the DEA is getting involved in terms of prevention and how current efforts are different than past ones.
So as you mentioned, Chloe, this is an all-government and all-commitment approach to this problem. This is not a single-solution problem. And so the DEA has really three priorities. One is to defeat the cartels. And stop, defeat Sinaloa and CJNG. Second priority is to increase awareness through education and prevention, which is what we're doing today. And then the third priority is to increase medical assisted treatment for those who need it the most. And so one thing the DEA did was they, once 2,000 practitioners had access to MAT treatment, now every practitioner in the country has access to MAT. And so this is DEA's, one of DEA's attempts to really increase our ability to help those who need it. And so we'll continue to do this, continue to evolve, and continue to address the threats on all levels in a holistic way. And we'll continue to address those who are the victims of this poison that is coming in from Mexico.
That's amazing.
That is so necessary.
You have evolved to, it sounds like the agency itself has really evolved in the work that they do, particularly with the community.
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, DEA is a law enforcement agency that also has regulatory responsibility, investigatory responsibility.
Yeah.
And so we are committed to also the health and wellness of people. Right, of the society that we live in the neighborhoods. And so whatever we need to do to you know, provide a better environment for the young people is what we're focused on.
That's wonderful. Well, I'm going to shift gears a little bit here before we wrap up a little break. How is the Mexican border related to the fentanyl crisis, and what can we do?
Yeah, so during your opening monologue, there was mention of the two most dominant cartels, but also the two most countries that are causing the greatest threat to the United States right now, and that's China and Mexico. They are, without a shadow of a doubt, the two most existential threats to the United States, both public health, public safety, and as well as a national security risk. Yeah. And what's happening is these precursor chemicals being manufactured in China are flowing freely into Mexico.
Yeah.
And then those precursor chemicals are being synthesized in super laboratories all throughout Mexico that are now manufacturing these fake fentanyl pills and the fake fentanyl prescription pills that are flooding into the United States and the fentanyl powder that is flooding into the United States. So all of that is coming from Mexico, and it's coming across our border, and it's coming by land, sea, and air. And so the Mexican cartels are using every available means to get that poison to the United States, and it comes over, through, and around the border.
Yeah, we need to stop this. Please discuss the Family Summit held in New York City last November. That's actually how I was introduced to you, through the wonderful Carol Trottier. I commend you and your colleagues for putting that together.
Well, again, you know, the DEA has taken a very forward-leaning approach, and they have developed the Faces of Fentanyl. So in Washington, D.C., in our headquarters, there's 5,000 names and faces on our wall that represent young people from ages 7 all the way up to older people as high as 70 who have died as a result of overdose drugs and poisonings from fentanyl and other drugs. And so the Faces of Fentanyl was one step in the direction of trying to educate the public, but also to learn from those who have lost loved ones. And so the Family Summit was an attempt to bring in those families who have suffered this loss, this tragic loss of an overdose death or a poisoning, and learn from them and understand what this problem really looks like from their eyes and from their perspective. And then we wanted to encourage them to use the information that we had to go out and be our surrogates, to go out and champion our message, and to go out and educate people, just like we're trying to do every day.
What an amazing collaboration. I understand it was quite successful.
It was a great turnout. The families were amazing. They were very open, and they shared a lot of really great information with us. And we're so blessed to have that experience, and we look forward to the next one.
Yeah, I think that's a great model to collaborate with the community like that. So thank you for that service. Before we go on to a little break, I think Taylor has one last question.
Yeah, one more question. Why is Narcan so important? And what about fentanyl test strips?
So, Taylor, great question on the Narcan. Narcan, or naloxone, is critically important to saving lives of not just those who overdose and potentially die, but also to the law enforcement officers who are out there every single day putting their lives on the line and encountering this poison during search warrants and arrest warrants and or any kind of law enforcement action. So we want to make sure that all of our law enforcement professionals have access to fentanyl, naloxone, to avoid a fentanyl poisoning. And so we give all of our agents the Narcan that they need. And then we also make sure that they have this available for the people that they encounter, to make sure that when they do a search warrant, arrest warrant, and somebody is in an overdose state, that they're available to give this life-saving tool and reverse that effect of fentanyl. And so again, it's a life-saving tool, and it's something that if it can save a life, we should use it. As far as the fentanyl test strips, I would just tell you that it is another tool that has some upside, and I would say it also has some false sense of security. Fentanyl test strips can be used provided that the intended user is responsible enough to ensure that the pill that they're going to test is completely crushed and tested in all aspects and not just a piece of it.
Yeah.
As you know, during your monologue, you said 6 out of 10 pills have a potential lethal dose. These are pills that aren't manufactured here in the United States in some really efficient and highly, monitored laboratory. These are made in labs, clandestine laboratories in Mexico with very little oversight and very little control. And so they're going to have hot spots in pills. And so you could test a piece of the pill, it could be completely fine, and then still take that pill and overdose and die. And again, these are usually people who have a strong desire to ingest that pill to seek that high. And they may want that pill to test negative just so that they can take it. So it's a little bit of a false sense of security. And then I think the risk is far too great and too high. The consequences are, as you know, lethal. And so these pills are not something to take lightly. And we would encourage them to not take that pill.
Yeah, that was well put. Thank you. Thank you, Frank. So we're going to do a little mid-wrap here. At this point, everyone knows someone who has died this way, and it can be prevented. So please educate one another. Parents, please talk to your kids. It may be the most important discussion you will ever have with them. So act now. Don't let the time pass and miss the opportunity. Fentanyl has flooded the street supply. One pill can end a person's life forever. So again, hey, listeners, please support our Radiothon for WUSB with your pledge. Whatever you can give is so appreciated. Thank you for your donation and continued support. Your donation keeps us on the air and in your ears. You can donate on the website, WUSB.FM, or call 631-632-6901. Thank you. So I have a very special listener tuning in today. And I'd like to play a memorable song for him. This is for you, Dad. Everyone, this is A Wonderful World. Woo! So far, so good.
Trees of green.
Great questions.
Yeah.
Red roses, too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying how. Cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I never knew. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Oh, yeah.
Boy, do I love that. I love that song. And we do live in a wonderful world despite all this crazy stuff, you know?
Absolutely.
So welcome back, everyone. We are here with Special Agent Frank Tarentino. And so now here's Chloe to continue where we left off.
Yeah, so this is kind of probably a controversial question, but especially to a DEA agent. But suppose all drugs were decriminalized, like in Portugal, and they were regulated by the federal government, tax, and like sold cheaper than the street supply with greater access, like if that money was used for harm reduction and treatment and stuff like that. Would that put the cartels out of business? Probably not, but just asking.
And then just a follow-up to Chloe's question. So since the legalization of marijuana in New York State, have you seen lesser drug trafficking activity?
Okay, so I'm going to take Chloe's question first, and I'll get to Aisha's question. First, I would just say that the cartels are very innovative and creative and constantly evolving, which is why today we're dealing with fentanyl the way we are. Chapo Guzman was the first one to introduce fentanyl into the drug supply that emanated from Mexico, and he did that to increase his customer base. He did that to drive addiction. He did that because he wanted to make more money. All right, and so then you have his sons that take over along with one of the other cartel members who is a significant role player at this point in time, and they increased the amount of fentanyl that was flooding into the United States, and they increased the amount of fentanyl that was being put into these drugs. So the cartel is going to continue to evolve. If you take fentanyl off the table, they're going to find another synthetic drug that is am I still on the air?
Yeah, we're good.
Just lower your mic.
Okay. So yeah, they're going to find another synthetic drug that will replace fentanyl and will be more powerful. And then if you think about what's happened with marijuana and we look at the black market, and there's always going to be a black market, and the cartels and every other drug trafficking organizations, transnational criminal organizations, are going to try to take advantage of the black market. And so what we're seeing now is these wholesale marijuana grow and distribution points across the country that are popping up, and usually they're manned by foreign nationals that are coming from Southeast Asia and from other parts of the world that are making millions and millions of dollars, and it's really increased the amount of violence in our inner cities. And so that is a legal drug in some places throughout New York City at the moment, but still there's this underground black market that exists, that's going to continue to exist, that's going to continue to fuel the violence in New York City and other places.
What a mess it is. Why is there such an increase right now in synthetic drugs compared to before? I know that they're cheaper to produce than, let's say, cocaine, heroin, and all that, but why now?
Well, again, I think that the cartels, if we think about them as a business, right? This is a business for them. So they've evolved, and we call them the criminal version of Amazon. They understand how to market their product. They understand how to get their product from the manufacturing to the distribution, to the wholesale, retail, street level distribution. They've understood this for years, but they've also now understood the time, resource, and energy that's involved in plant-based narcotics like the coca leaf and the poppy plant. And so now when you can reduce all of that time, energy, and cost by a synthetic made drug like fentanyl, that's more powerful, that's more addicting, that's more profitable, then that's where they've shifted. And so when I operated with our FAST teams in Afghanistan, the number one poppy producing country in the world, poppy and opium and heroin were the predominant drug in Afghanistan. We're seeing even Afghanistan shift to a man-made synthetic drug. Wow. So you can see the evolution of drug trafficking and drug production. And this is not dissimilar than globalization in any country, in any form of technology or any form of business.
Wow. Yeah, thank you.
So you mentioned during our meeting last week that this is the worst drug crisis that we've ever had. Do you see an end in sight? Do you see, you know, I know that's kind of a broad question, but, you know, are we moving in a direction of coming out of this?
So, yeah, Kurt, you know, the numbers are staggering, and it is the greatest threat that we have ever faced in drug law enforcement. Fentanyl has killed more people than ever before. And in fact, the numbers from 2000 and 2021 of August to 2022 of August, it's 107,735.
Wow.
So it's almost 108,000 people. And we're talking about 295 people every single day mm-hmm. that die. In the hour that we're going to talk here today, 12 people will die.
Yeah.
That's incredible.
From a poisoning. And so that is the reality that we live in. But I will just say this, that we are, as a government approach, all federal law enforcement, specifically the DEA, are working tirelessly to drive down drug-related deaths and drug-related violence. Wow. We're working at defeating the cartels. We're working at prevention, education, awareness. We issued 3 public safety alerts in the last year, last 18 months, and that's the first time we issued one in 6 years.
Wow.
And so we're working really hard at trying to get our message out there and trying to educate people. And we will see a decrease, and because that's our effort, right? Yeah. That's our focus. We're laser focused on defeating the cartels, but also saving lives.
Mm. That's great.
It's a chemical attack on our country, it seems.
Absolutely. This is why China and Mexico need to be held accountable.
Well, where is the outrage from our media outlets regarding this problem?
Well, I will say that we have been very fortunate in the New York division and across the country with the opportunity to share the work that we're doing with a lot of very helpful media stations to, again, stand shoulder to shoulder with us to get our message out there. I think that what we'd want is for more people to be aware of this threat and for more people to have honest, mm-hmm. genuine conversations with the most vulnerable. And so that means parents, educators, yeah. caregivers, people in areas of responsibility, sit down and have this conversation, because fentanyl does not discriminate. Fentanyl mm-hmm. is everywhere. It's in everything. And fentanyl does not care what race, creed, religion, socioeconomic background you come from. It is a devastating drug that will kill anyone it comes in contact with.
And it should not be a political problem either.
No, Allison, this is actually a red, white, and blue problem.
Yeah, mm. yeah. Just had to point that out. Aisha, here you go.
Okay, so I have a couple of questions. But first, what ways do you think that we can get this message out to young people?
Well, this is one step
yes.
in the right direction. Yeah. So thank you for that. You're all doing great work, and I applaud you for taking on this really important topic. And I think that we need to continue to have this conversation in all media outlets and all platforms. Social media is a weapon that the cartels are using, but we need to flip the table on them and right. use it in an alternative way to get our message out there. And I think we're doing that, but people like yourself can help us with that.
Okay. And I'm kind of shifting gears a little bit. I was like interested in your work overseas. So I was thinking I know that there's a really big difference, but how does that compare to your work here in New York State? And when you were overseas, were there any local agencies that you had to work with? And was it challenging to integrate yourself into another community and to be able to earn their trust to like allow you to work there?
So again, Aisha, very thoughtful and great question. You know, the DEA does not operate unilaterally in the countries that we're in. So we're in 69 different countries. We have 93 offices across those 69 countries. And we work collaboratively with our host nation counterparts. We work very closely with the other government agencies in those particular countries, but we really are successful based on the relationships that we're able to make. And we have, in some of those countries, surrogates or people that are in law enforcement in those countries that are vetted through us to work collaboratively with us on the threats in their particular area. Now, in Afghanistan, it's a completely different situation. As a foreign deployed advisory support team member of Fast Team Charlie, and eventually, or I started at Fast Team Alpha and then promoted to Fast Team Charlie, that's a different scenario because we were operating in a war zone. And so the partnerships there really depended upon our ability to line up with the military organizations that were operating over there, and whether it was U.S. Special Forces or British Special Forces or Australian Special Forces, we were able to build up a reputation and a reciprocal amount of respect and camaraderie to operate jointly with them, along with our host nation counterparts, the Afghans. So everywhere we went, we brought Afghan counterparts with us to go after those counter-narcotics, counter-terrorism targets. And we were very successful. You can go through a list of Haji Juma Khan, Haji Bashir Noorzai, Khan Muhammad, Haji Baz Muhammad. These are all high-level targets that were brought to justice from Afghanistan to the United States in successful operations. That shows you the DEA's ability to go globally after the most significant targets. We call it the global pursuit, and we're successful every single day in that.
Wow. Really impressive.
That is very impressive. It's good to hear that you're able to do that to earn the trust of everybody there and work towards a common goal. So shifting gears again, So when you're prosecuting a cartel, how does the DEA trace the extent of drug proliferation caused by that cartel?
Mm-hmm.
How can you tell how far the drug has reached?
Great question.
Thanks.
I know I said that a lot today, but they all really are great questions. I would just say that the DEA, as a global organization, working collaboratively with our state, local, and federal counterparts, we're able to have visibility on the global spectrum of drug trafficking in these organizations. And so we've been successful right now in mapping that threat and understanding how widespread the cartels are. And so we have now identified the cartels in 47 different countries. We understand that there's thousands and thousands of cartel members, associates, brokers, facilitators that are operating on a global scale. We understand how many of them are operating in the United States. And so we look at the data and we look at their investigations that are connected across the country and across the globe, and we're able to identify where those commonalities are. So we connect the dots. And so that gives us the perspective that we need. And again, you know about the Chipito indictment that was released or unsealed a few weeks back by Administrator Milgram. This was collaborative work that was done by multiple DEA offices across the country, four judicial districts, the Southern District of New York, the Southern District of California, the Northern District of Illinois, and the District of Columbia, all four districts working together to bring an indictment against the 28 most significant cartel members in Sinaloa.
Hmm. Wow, congratulations on that.
Congratulations.
Amazing. And I just want to, I have a little correction here. With all due respect, Frank, for his title, Frank Tarantino's official title is Special Agent in Charge, which you obviously have earned, and so we want to get that right.
Well, thank you, Allison. I still consider myself a special agent. It's still in my it says that in my credentials, and I appreciate that acknowledgement. But yes, I'm very, very fortunate to still call myself a special agent. So thank you.
You are very special. So, Arcadia.
Yes. So can you please explain the campaign One Pill Can Kill vehicle advertisement?
Well, I would just say that, Orcadia, that's a great question again. But when you say vehicle, are you talking about do you know about our vehicle, or are you just using that as a metaphor? So we have a vehicle.
Yeah.
Do you know about our vehicle?
Did I think you mentioned it. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I think you mentioned it.
So I'll get to that. That's a really great, I think, tool and prevention, education, awareness piece that we have. So One Pill Can Kill is a public awareness campaign the DEA launched roughly 16, 18 months ago. And this is really to do a lot of what we've discussed already, and that's to educate people, to educate parents, educators, caregivers on the threat that we're facing today. And the threat is, as you know, is that all of these pills that you're seeing on social media are fake. And not only are they just fake, but they're almost always going to be laced with fentanyl. And when we talk about the lethality of fentanyl, we're talking about a very small dosage. You mentioned it earlier in your opening, about 2 milligrams. So just to put that into perspective, we have to take, if you can imagine any one of you being skillful enough to take a salt shaker and pour out 10 to 20 grains of salt on the table, that's the lethality of fentanyl. So that's 2 milligrams. It fits on the tip of a pencil. We're not talking about a lot of powder here. We're talking about a very small amount that can kill people. And so when we talk about one pill can kill, it's because, unfortunately, a lot of these young people who have experienced or have been interested in experimenting with with fake drugs, with fake fentanyl pills or fake prescription pills. They're ingesting a lethal pill. They're taking that risk of dying by just taking one pill. Mm. And so that's why we say today it is just not safe to use. It's not safe to experiment. The dangers are too high. And so One Pill Can Kill messaging campaign also talks a lot about the social media and how we're trying to hold these social media platforms accountable.
Great.
I was just about to ask you about that, because we are talking about social media. We're talking about how this is targeted towards very young people who primarily use social media to get their news, right? But they're also getting the drugs on particularly Snapchat, right? Mm-hmm.
WhatsApp, why aren't there
PSAs on their platforms, and how do we go after them?
So, Allison, these are questions that we ask every single day of these social media platforms, and they need to do a better job of scraping their platforms to make sure that they can pull off these drug traffickers, because they are hiding behind the monikers on social media. These organizations, these Snapchats and Facebook Messenger and YouTube and Instagram, they have the ability to scrape their platforms and pull off content. And so they most definitely need to do a better job. And this is what we're holding them accountable to. And we're working with them. And we're trying to get them, educate them, and make them more responsive to this threat that we face. And these drug trafficking organizations have weaponized social media in a way that we've never seen before. Yeah. These cell phones that everybody has today, it's like having a drug trafficker in your pocket and accessible at any point in time, at any time throughout the day. You can essentially dial up a drug trafficker. And so the drug trafficking that we once saw on the city streets of New York in dark alleys in very austere conditions now exists on Instagram. It exists on Snapchat. So this is what parents and caregivers and educators need to be worried about today.
Absolutely. Thank you for answering that question.
Do you think presentations about this to elementary school are necessary?
Is that too young?
No, I don't. I don't think anybody that is in elementary school is too young. I think the more that we can educate young people on the threat and the dangers of ingesting a pill or any substance that's not coming from a prescribed doctor,
right,
or dispensed from a licensed pharmacist, is not only illegal, but it's dangerous.
Yeah.
And so that education isn't, I think, irresponsible. I actually think it's very responsible to talk to young people about taking things from people that don't come from their parents or doesn't come from a doctor.
Right, age-appropriate type of presentation.
Yeah.
But get them while they're young, basically, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. You know, first of all, you are an amazing guest, and thank you again for your wonderful service. Does anyone else have anything more to ask Frank before we wrap up the show?
Yeah.
Of course.
So, you served in the military, right? So
yes.
Thank you for your service. Thank of course. I just kind of wanted to point out that people who suffer with this opioid addiction, a lot of them are like ex-military, mm-hmm. or like they're, they've come back and then they're injured, and then, they are prescribed a pill, and then, that develops into an addiction. So is there like a specific role for like the DEA to help those people?
Well, yes. Yeah. I mean, I think that we have a responsibility to help as many people as we can. And that's the mission, is to save lives, right? And so in doing that, if that means increasing our education, prevention, and awareness at all levels, that would be a step in the right direction. And I want to be absolutely clear about this. We are very focused on the organizations, the cartels that are causing the most harm, the drug trafficking organizations at the highest level that are responsible for flooding the United States with fentanyl powder and fentanyl pills. The end user is the victim, and we want to work collaboratively with our communities to help those that are not opioid naive and that are the most vulnerable, so that they can avoid these overdoses and then avoid more poisonings and deaths. And so this is DEA's attempt to get as far and wide into the community and across America to educate people and to prevent overdose deaths and poisonings from happening in the first place. And if that means looking at all different organizations and all parts of you know, the business and private sectors, then that's what we need to do.
Well, Frank, thank you so much. Thank you again. We're going to wrap up the show. We hope you come back.
Thank you.
I hope a lot of people were listening. It's amazing information. And again, thank you for your service. So here's Chloe to help wrap it up for us.
All right. With gracious thanks, we're all in this together. Sincerely thank everyone who supports this cause and understands how important it is to look out for each other and to empathize with anyone you know who's dealing with addiction. Please educate one another about illicit fentanyl and various harm reduction measures such as Narcan and Zimai and xylazine fentanyl test strips, drug checking with mass spectrometry, supervised consumption that can reduce overdose, and syringe service providers who can provide access to clean syringes to reduce the risk of HIV and hepatitis. You can locate your nearest SSP through NASEN, which is North America's Syringe Exchange Network. It will often deliver the supplies. Additionally, as you mentioned, medication-assisted therapy or treatment such as methadone, Suboxone, Sublocaine, Vivitrol, Naltrexone, those are available to those who are struggling with opioid use disorder. There's plenty of help and support available for recovery, from peer-based support such as Narcotics Anonymous and SMART to professional treatment. And here's Kurt to provide some additional resources.
SAMHSA's Treatment Referral and Info Helpline is 1-800-662-HELP. If you prefer to text, you can write HELP, the number 4 and the letter U with no spaces. Likewise, there is a free, confidential, 24-hour-a-day, 365-day-a-year information services that offers help for mental and substance use disorders, prevention, and recovery. This number is 1-800-487-4889. That's 1-800-487-4889. Another incredible resource, one that we highly recommend, is LICAD, Long Island Council on Alcoholism and Drug Dependence, addresses the addictive climate of our times by providing initial attention and referral services to individuals, families, and children. They offer intervention, education, and professional guidance to overcome the ravages of alcohol and other drug-related problems. LICAD has a fantastic user-friendly website that is licad.org, and their number is 631-979-1700. Aisha.
For those who may not be ready for treatment, Never Use Alone Hotline is a toll-free nationwide overdose prevention, detection, crisis response, and reversal lifeline service for people who use drugs alone. If you call their number, volunteers will stay on the line to ensure that you don't become unresponsive, and if you do, they will send for EMS, never police, and they've saved many lives so far. So just write this number down, save it in your contacts. The Never Use Alone hotline is 1-800-484-3731. Once again, it's 1-800-484-3731.
If anybody missed this information or wants to review our show, please follow us on Instagram at sbu.playitforward, and you can listen to all of our previous shows on YouTube at the Play It Forward Project. We hope that our message reaches somebody, and it would be great to hear from you. So for now and always,
keep playing it forward!
Yes, and I just want to thank Frank again. I think you had one more thing you'd like to mention before we go off the air.
I do. I want to thank every one of you who are here today. The Play It Forward team is an amazing team. And Allison, thank you for your leadership. It's really great.
Thank you.
I really do look forward to coming back. I hope you do have me. Yeah. I would just add that the DEA is hiring. and right. So anybody out there that's listening,
absolutely,
there is an opportunity that awaits you in the drug law enforcement world of the Drug Enforcement Administration. And you can go to our website, DEA.gov, and you can look at all the different opportunities that exist, and we would love to have you.
Thank you for that. That's awesome. Sign up, people. So this is Allison of the Play It Forward Project, and I hope you tune in to our next show on May 12th from 1 to 2 p.m. And one more time, so listeners, please support our radiothon for WUSB with your pledge. Whatever you can give is so supported and appreciated. Thank you for your donation. It keeps us on the air and in your ears. You can donate on the website WUSB.FM or call 631-632-6901 or 1-888-632-9872. Thank you, everyone, for your contribution. Again, thanks to WUSB, our think tank, Chloe, Aisha, Ishrat, Taylor, Arcadia, Serena, and Olivia, and Kurt. And, of course, our amazing special guest, Special Agent in Charge, New York, Frank Tarentino.
Thank you, Allison.
Before we close, I'm proud to say we held the fifth annual campus-wide Narcan training event in honor of my brother, Stephen Vancott, here at Stony Brook University with the amazing Dr. Catherine Mamrone and all of the SBU staff and faculty. Thank you all for supporting that event. Shout out to SOCH339 and everyone at the university for getting Narcan trained on Wednesday. So here's a great song for all the champions of this cause, especially the brave and honorable DEA. Thank you again for your service. This song is for all of you guys. Yes. You are listening to WUSB Stony Brook 90.1 and 107.3 FM. Be well, everyone, and please look out for one another.
I've paid my dues. Time after time, I've done my sentence, but committed no crime. And bad mistakes, I've made a few. I've had my share of bad kicks in my face. Thank you all, but it's been no bed of roses.